Movement Nation, thank you for tuning in to our weekly podcast. If this is your first time tuning in to our podcast, listen, friends, I'm so excited that you did. I want to introduce you to an authentic, engaging, thought-provoking experience. My name is Dre Burgs. I am the visionary architect and one of the directional leaders of this church movement called Movement Church. Movement Church is a network of simple churches called city groups, people that have been drawn together into the mission of our Savior Jesus Christ by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Listen, friends, we are excited about our new strategic initiative called Do Good Friday. Within the last 30 days, we've all experienced life like never before. Things that seem simple and routine, much like breathing, have now created a consciousness about valuing life, helping your fellow man, and not really taking small things for granted. And so we know that during this time, many people have experienced hardships, or they need an indicator that God is still near and that God is still good. So what we're doing is we're taking our Do Good Friday initiative and we're integrating it into a weekly practice. Doing good is a practice of good stewardship, and we intend to be a conduit of sharing love of Christ by meeting the needs of those that need to experience His goodness. Listen, friends, we're not a community of do-gooders. We just intentionally do good by way of the gospel. And so through this tangible and active representation of living out our rhythms, moving up to connect to Christ, moving out to connect to culture, moving in to connect the culture to Christ, we're going to embrace Do Good Friday. Friends, you may be asking, how does it work? It's very, very simple. No membership or partnership to Movement Church is required. No matter who you are, your age or your income, where you live, your creed, your race, your age, your sex, you get it. Everyone can receive a little goodness. And so with Do Good Friday, we ask that you submit a CARES application on our website, movementchurch.tv or dogoodfriday.com. A little goodness can go a long way. Now, I need you to stop everything. Take out your phone and download the movementchurch.tv app. Search Movement Nation in your Apple Store or Google Play. Please search Movement Nation. Now, friends, thank you so much for tuning in to this weekly podcast. Tune in now to experience how the gospel can truly transform your life. On this week, hey, listen, friends, as you all know, we have three rhythms of our church movement. That first rhythm is to move up, to connect to Christ. And what we do there is we spend time with Jesus. And over the last, I would say, 4 to 5 weeks, close to even 6 weeks now, we've all been having to slow down. We've been forced to practice social distancing. We've been forced to practice silence and slowing and solitude. And in this season of slowing, silence, and solitude, we've been able to truly connect with Christ. We've been able to spend some time with Jesus through fasting, through prayer, through meditation, through a multitude of spiritual disciplines. And so, friends, as we continue in our teachings, as we continue discussing and talking about that which we've been discussing, our rhythms and what it means to be a part of a church movement, what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, what it means to be mentored to move others into this thing called the church, people that have been drawn together into the mission of Jesus Christ by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And so, friends, as we've discussed being with Jesus, as we have discussed what it means to move up and to connect to Christ, we want to continue in our very fundamental and practical teachings. And this week, we want to kind of turn the page and we want to start looking at what it means to become like Jesus, what it means for us to move out, what it means for us to connect to culture. But before we can do those things, I believe it is imperative. I believe it is vitally important that we spend some time not just moving out, but that we spend some time looking back over our own individual lives, taking a personal assessment of our divine design, taking a personal assessment of how God has wired us, how God has created us, and how God ultimately wants to use us. Again, it's not about what we see ourselves being. Ultimately, it's about who we should become in Christ Jesus, becoming like Jesus. That's it. Our entire lives is a pursuit to be with Jesus, to become like Jesus, and to do what Jesus did. Our entire life's pursuit is to move up. It's to move out, brothers and sisters, friends and family. It is to move in. And so as we have spent that time in rest, as we have spent that time slowing down, as we have spent the time in silence, solitude, prayer, fasting, and some of you possibly have begun creating the disciplines for the practice of the Sabbath. So we're just praying that the last few weeks' teachings and the last few weeks that we have gathered on Zoom and that we have gathered corporately and collectively as a church body in Christian community has been beneficial for you and to you. We pray that God has been working and or moving in your life to transform you and to conform you into the image of His Son, Christ Jesus. So this week, what are we going to discuss, friends and family? What are we looking at this week? We are turning the page and we are discussing what it means for us to become like Jesus. How do we actually change to become like Jesus? That is the question that maybe you have pondered and wrestled with for some time now. How do we change to become like Jesus? How do we change to become like Jesus? This is a real and authentic question. This is a question that I believe warrants us spending some time in. It warrants us exploring the question, how do we actually change to become like Jesus? What is it, Pastor Dre, that I should be doing so that I can change to become like Jesus? Is it simply me practicing those spiritual disciplines? Is it simply me spending some time in slowing, solitude? Is it simply me practicing the spiritual disciplines of prayer or fasting or meditation? What is it, Pastor Dre? How is it that I become more like Jesus? This has been the question that you've asked for maybe some years now. This is a question that you've pondered. Maybe you've scratched your head. You've wondered, how is it that I become like Jesus? I heard that there's nothing that I can do. I heard that there's nothing that I can do. But I want to challenge that particular myth. I believe there are some things that you and I can do personally. There is something called God's sovereignty, but human responsibility. And what I want to deal with this week is human responsibility. I want us to look at our past. I believe that becoming like Jesus is real. I believe that we can all become like Jesus. I believe that we can authentically be transformed and conformed into Jesus's character, into His Christ-likeness. I believe that we can put on the character of our Messiah. But before we can do that, before it's more than just belief, I believe, and Jesus says in John chapter 8, verse number 31, and we've been dealing with this for the last few weeks. We've talked about the principle of stick-to-itiveness. We've talked about continuing in His Word. But I want to also talk about this week, dealing with our past, because you can continue in His Word and not deal with your past. And if you don't deal with your past, I don't believe that there can truly be some transformation in our lives. For most of us, our family of origin is the single greatest influence on our life, for good or for evil. Let me say that again. For most of us, how we were raised, our atmosphere, we are typically products of our environment. So for most of us, for most of you, how you were raised determines and dictates. It is the most simple or the single greatest influence on your life. How you was raised, your family, or the origin of said family dictates one of the greatest influences on your life. That's whether it be for positive or for negative, for good or for evil. So what does your past mean for your present? That is the question that I believe I want to deal with this week. And I believe it would be advantageous. I believe, and I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, friends and family, as you are watching this podcast this week, as you have tuned in all over the nation, Texas, San Antonio, Houston, Dallas, as you have tuned in to the weekly podcast in Charlotte and Maryland, and Nashville, wherever you have tuned in to this podcast, Chicago, wherever you've tuned in to this podcast, brothers and sisters, friends and family, the question that we place on the table this day, the question that we will deal with this week is, what does your past mean for your present? Very few of us ever want to revisit the past. All we want to do is move from the now to the next. But what I want us to deal with is not the now, but I want us to deal with the past. Not now, not the next, but the past. And very few of us ever want to visit our past. But the reality is, our past is a predicator. It predicates and it influences our present. Our past predicates many times our present. Our past, it influences our presence. And so who you are and who we are has typically been shaped by where we come from and who we come from. We are typically products of our environment. For most of us, our family of origin is, again, the single greatest influence on our life, for good or for evil. And no matter how healthy your family is or your childhood experience was, on some level, every family is dysfunctional. Every family is dysfunctional. Let me say that again. Yes, your family, brother and sister, is dysfunctional. Every family is dysfunctional in some sense, in some shape, in some form, in some matter. Every family is dysfunctional. I know you had a great childhood, but your family is dysfunctional. I know you don't want to hear it. I know your mother was the greatest mother in the world. Your father was the greatest father in the world. However, brothers and sisters, come here. Let me borrow your time for a moment. Your family is in some shape, form, or fashion dysfunctional. All of our families in some shape, form, or fashion is dysfunctional. Every one of us will and every one of us has inherited ways of living from our family of origin and our culture that is some way or somehow not in sync with God's will, with God's way, and God's word. In other words, in some way, in some shape, form, or fashion, that which you learned from your parents is contradictory. It is antithetical to God's word. It is not the way that Jesus would do it. A lot of times we used to say back a few years ago, what would Jesus do? Many times what our fathers taught us to do is not what Jesus would have for us to do. Many times what your mother taught you to do is not what your Heavenly Father would have for you to do. And so, friends, we all inherit ways of living from our families that is contradictory to the ways of our heavenly family, our church family, our spiritual corporate communal family. So a key task in our apprenticeship, a key task in us becoming disciples that make disciples to Jesus is relearning how to be human in relationship with the Father. Let me say that again. A key component, a key task in our apprenticeship, a key task in us becoming disciples that make disciples is to relearn how to be human. Because our family of origin taught us one way to be human. However, our spiritual family teaches us another way to be human, to reflect the imagio Dei, to reflect the image of God is to truly be human. And what our earthly families have taught us has not always been a true reflection of the image of God. I pray that I'm making sense. I pray that you're keeping up. I pray that you are understanding that which is being said today. And so as we begin to explore, as we begin to explicate, as we begin to understand what we are dealing with today, I believe it is vitally important for me to restate and to put the question back on the table again. What does your past mean for your present? Follow along, because over the next few weeks, what we're going to do is we're going to recommend that you work through as a community. We're going to recommend that you work through as a church on the move. We're going to recommend that as you work through in your city groups, as you work through these issues as a family around your own personal dinner tables, we're going to suggest that you get with whomever God has ordained for you to get with in this season of pandemic, in this season of social isolation and social distancing, in this season. What we're praying is that God would allow this time for you to truly deal with your past, so that your past doesn't continue to negatively impact or affect or infect your future. And so this week, what we really want to begin laying the fundamental foundation for is generational sin. Every family is dysfunctional. Say that with me, because I need for you to understand that every family, brothers and sisters, is dysfunctional. Every family is dysfunctional. My family is dysfunctional. I need to own that, and you need to own that as well. Every family is dysfunctional. Our family is dysfunctional. Our church family is dysfunctional. And as soon as you believe that your church is not dysfunctional, it means that you believe that you are perfect. If you are part of any body of Christ, if you are part of any organization, that organization ceased to be perfect. Why? Because you and I are a part of it. We are not perfect. We are not perfect people. And so every family has to realize that every functional or every family is dysfunctional. And we all have some type of emotional baggage. We all have some type of pain, some type of hurt, some type of habit, some type of issue that we carry from our past. And so as we look at the 51st number of the Psalm, I want to read it for you. The very first 11 to 12 verses, the text says, be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, verse number 5 says, I was brought forth in iniquity. I need you to understand this right here. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity. That's that family dysfunctional. That's the dysfunctional aspect of the family. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin, the Bible says, my mother conceived me. I told you, every family, brothers and sisters, is dysfunctional. The text says, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Every family is dysfunctional, and we all, from some way, from some experience, we carry emotional baggage. And so we can deduct right here in the text that we all are dysfunctional. So the text says, purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out my transgressions. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Verse number 12, restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit. The grass withers, the flowers fade, the word of our Lord stands forever. As we just look here in the text again, the reason why I took us to that text is because I wanted us to see the dysfunctional aspects that we all have been born into. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. The first record of humanity, the first recorded husband and wife, was disastrous. They disobeyed God. Dysfunctional family, Genesis chapter 3. The firstborn commits murder. Sarah grieves over infertility, and she moves on her behalf, not on God's behalf. Her servant Hagar to Abraham to give birth to him. Dysfunctional families. Lot reluctantly leaves. Perverse Sodom. Dysfunctional families. Then later on, he is weakened and seduced by his daughters. Isaac and Rebekah place favorites with Esau and Jacob. Esau has no discernment and he gives away his birthright. Jacob is a conniver. He is a manipulator. He is deceitful and he deceives his brother out of his own birthright. Uncle Laban, what does he do in Genesis 29? He deceives his own nephew and he has him break Leviticus chapter 18, verse number 18, which says, "And you shall not take a woman as a rival wife to her sister." Dysfunctional families. Jacob's daughter is raped by a pagan. Dysfunctional family. Jacob's oldest son, Reuben, can't resist his incestuous desires and sleeps with one of his own father's concubines, the mother of some of his brothers. Dysfunctional families, brothers and sisters. So we can see all throughout Scripture, Saul had a dysfunctional family. King David had a dysfunctional family. Solomon was dysfunctional. Jesus even came from a dysfunctional family. And so why is the Bible loud on sinful, dysfunctional families? And so quiet on harmonious families? It's because all of us, the Bible says, were brought forth in iniquity. As a result of the fallen nature of humanity, the Bible says in the 51st number of the Psalms, friends, that you and I were brought forth in iniquity, and in sin our mothers conceived us. And so for one thing, our families are not harmonious. Humanity, brothers and sisters, the text is saying is not harmonious. We are alienated from God, and we are alienated from each other. And so put, alienation creates selfishness, and selfish sinners together all in a home. And I don't know if you've experienced it over the last 5-6 weeks. I don't know if you've experienced it as we've all been forced to practice slowing silence and solitude, but you and I, we are born in sin. We are shaped in iniquity. We were brought forth in iniquity, and in sin our mothers conceived us. And because we are sinful in nature, our selfish desires will rear their ugly heads at any point in time in all of our family life. And that's when the family becomes and begins to feel the dysfunction as a result of the dysfunctional aspects of who we are when we are far apart and away from God. And so as we look and as we examine how you and I become like Jesus, we become like Jesus by dealing with our past. And our past says that we were brought forth in iniquity. Our past says that we were conceived in sin. And so for one thing, most families have to deal with this fact. All families have to deal with this fact. The Bible's main theme is God is gracious, and he has this gracious plan to redeem needy sinners. You and I, in our selfishness, you and I, even though we come from dysfunctional families, God has this great plan to redeem needy sinners. It teaches us that what God wants most from us and for us is that we become aware of our sinfulness and our powerlessness to save ourselves as we believe and love his son and the gospel that his son preached and graciously love one another. And it turns out that the family is the ideal place for all of this to occur. This is the reason why, brothers and sisters, this is the reason why, friends and family, we've talked about loving God with all of our heart, all of our soul, mind, and strength, but also to love our near ones, our oikos, our family, those that are in our relational network, those that are nearest to us, because as it turns out, the family is the ideal place for us to practice the grace that we have received from a gracious and a compassionate and a loving and a redeeming and a saving God. And so if we are going to get back on track, I want you all to write these practical things down. God will use dysfunctional people. Hear me. God will use dysfunctional people, families, and God will use dysfunctional churches, and God will use dysfunctional nations. God can use all of this. He can redeem all people. He can redeem all families. He can redeem all churches. He can redeem all nations. God uses dysfunctional people. He uses dysfunctional families. He uses dysfunctional churches, and he will use a dysfunctional yet nation to bring back the function, the plan, and the purpose that he has for you and for I. He will use, and God can use, broken people to get other people back on track. And so no person, no family, no church or nation is beyond the blessing, is beyond the blessing of God. If you truly have the Father's heart, if you have read Malachi chapter 1, verse number 11, if you have ever read Revelation chapter 7, verse number 9, if you have ever read 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 9, or Matthew chapter 28, you know that the Father's heart is that no person, no family, nor nation, nor church, nobody is beyond the blessing of God. No one is beyond his heart. No one. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That is the cosmos. That is everyone. Whosoever believeth in him, whosoever believes, that's you, sir, that's you, ma'am, that's to those who would believe in his work, but not just believe, but that would also stick to his word. And so no person, no family, no matter how dysfunctional your family is, no matter how dysfunctional of a family you have come from, no person, no family, no church, no nation is beyond the blessing of God. You can always get back on track. And how do you do that? It comes through repentance. Repentance leads to reconciliation. Repentance, brothers and sisters, leads to reconciliation. Turn from your sin and turn to God. Turn from an existing object of trust and turn to God. Turn from that brokenness. Deal with your past. Turn from that broken marriage. Turn from that incestuous relationship. Turn from your hurt. Turn from your habit. Turn from your pain and trust God in redeeming, in restoring, in bringing back function into your dysfunction. God wants to use you, brother and sister. He wants to use you, family. He wants to use your family. He wants to use that which has been dysfunctional for a greater good, for his glory. Don't let the past and unrepented sin rule you or hold you hostage or hold you back from turning from your existing object of faith and turning to Christ Jesus. Don't let it happen, brothers and sisters. Don't let what you have dealt with in the past hold you hostage or hold you as a prisoner. You are not disqualified from service. You are qualified. Allow the Lord to restore you. That's all you have to do, is allow him to restore you, allow him to redeem you through his redemptive work. And then seek the Lord continuously. Let me say that again. Seek the Lord continuously. Seek the Lord continuously. Now, there is a difference between continuously and continual. Let me say that again. I need for you all to understand, as I pause and parenthetically and state right here, there is a difference between continuous and continual. Continuous and continual. There is a difference. And brothers and sisters, we need to learn how to distinguish the difference between continuous and continual. Continual, very often at regular or frequent intervals. All right, that's continual. Very often. Regular, frequent intervals. That is continual. Regular attendance. Regular or frequent intervals. That's continual. However, continuous is unceasing. It's constant. Not regular, not frequent. It's unceasing. It's constant. We have to seek the Lord continuous, not continual. We must seek the Lord not frequently on Sundays during a podcast party, not on Tuesdays during our church on the move, not on Wednesdays during our mentor meet a move, not on Thursdays during our church on the move, or whenever we are deciding to continual, regularly or frequently, very often attach or seek the Lord. We must continuously, unceasingly, constantly, without cease, seek the Lord. And as you and I continuously seek the Lord, as we continuously, constantly, without interruption, seek the Lord, we must also allow God to turn our disappointments into appointments. I know, friends, you've come from a very dysfunctional family. We've all come from some type of dysfunctional family. My family is a dysfunctional family. I was born in sin, shaped in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me, brothers and sisters. But what we've got to understand, friends, is God will turn disappointments into appointments. So we have to press into our past. And this is what I'm encouraging us to do this week in Christian community, is to press into our past, press into our hurts, and allow God to redeem those very things. We must do that by seeking Him continuously. Not allowing our past and unrepented sin rule us or hold us back from being all or becoming all that Christ wants us to become. We do that by repenting. We do that by getting back on track. None of us are exempt or beyond the blessing of God. You've got to believe that, brothers and sisters, on this day. Let us pray. Corporately, let us pray collectively this week that as you and I continue, as we continue to not just move up, to connect to Him by spending time with Him through silence, solitude, prayer, fasting, scripture reading, and scripture memorization, but also during this time, brothers and sisters, let us become like Him. And in order for us to become like Him, we've got to understand where we come from. Deal with our past. Deal with our hurts. Deal with our hangups. Deal with our habits. Deal with our family dysfunction. So let's press in to our hurt. Let's press in to our pain. Let's press in to our past and discover the patterns in our family of origin that have greatly influenced our lives. God, we thank You today. We thank You for this weekend message. God, we pray that as we gather corporately and collectively, possibly, God, even as we watch this message via our app on demand, God, we pray that this word would rest in the spirit of Your sons and Your daughters, and that they would deal with their past, press in to the patterns of their family dysfunction that has caused them to be who they are today and that has hindered them from becoming who You would have for us all to become, individually but also corporately and collectively. This is our prayer, and we pray it, God, in Your Son's name. Shall we all say amen.
We hope this week's message inspired you. We hope it builds your faith. We hope that it gives you perspective to see how the gospel can truly transform your life. If this church movement has been a blessing to you and you'd like to support this ministry financially, you can do so online. help us bring messages just like this one to you each week. Hey, thanks again. We are Movements and we are the church. For more info, log on to our website or follow us on Instagram at movementchurch.tv.